because they have video live.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm sure with that introduction, even if you're not fallen asleep after lunch, that would have put you to sleep, I guess, yeah? Thank you very much for having me over, and I must also convey my apologies to the organizers for coming in late this morning and putting them to a bit of a difficulty. So hopefully I'll try and wake you guys up and not let you sleep. And normally whenever people invite me to sort of come and say a few words, I like it to be before lunch, but today by default it has sort of happened to be after lunch. But let me try and share some some data points here which I have compiled over the last about 6-7 months. And I'm sure for many of you this may not be news, but nevertheless. It says that we lose 3 people every 2 minutes to cancer in India today. 1.2 million infants and 50,000 mothers die each year at childbirth. Every 4 seconds, one person becomes a victim of dementia. In next 15 years, suffering from Alzheimer's will be double of what it is today. About 15 million people in India are blind, 1/3 of world's blindness. 3 million people develop cataract in India every year. Yeah? So I'm sure the points to wake you guys up quite sufficiently. Number of diabetics expected to almost double in a period of 15 years and reach over 130 million by 2030. And there's more. A combination of poor availability, high cost, and unpredictable quality of healthcare delivery of marginalized population. I think people sitting around this room, we are like at the top 200 million people who over the next several decades, we will run all the way to great healthcare. We will have access, we'll be able to afford, our companies will afford, we'll have insurance. And we are getting smart, we'll live better. But I think we'll be like 200 million people. There are going to be that 1 billion people who are going to continue to suffer and struggle. Inadequate quality of service at government hospitals, unaffordable to folks at the low end of the pyramid. The ratio of rural population to doctors is 6 times lower than in urban India. 50% of the posts of gynecologists and related are lying vacant today. Over 30% of rural population in India has to travel over 30 kilometers to get medical attention. Yeah? 65% of rural population in India lack access to preventive medicines. Guys, this is not about archives. It's all data points that I've picked it up over the last about 8-9 months. And I keep updating them to see how we are moving. It's not all that bad in the sense the needle is moving, but the needle is moving so slowly that we should better be, there are good reasons for us to be scared, I guess. This is 3 trillion cumulative healthcare spending requirement by 2025, 3 trillion. That's what we are looking at. Speakers this morning talked about 75% population with no health insurance. 1.3% of GDP as public spending as against the US and all that. We know the data, 18% and all that stuff. Just non-communicable diseases, if we don't attend to it, the cumulative loss on economic loss would be $6 trillion by 2030. This is the cost of poor healthcare. 2 out of 3 Indians are financially struggling. Healthcare costs are pushing over 50 million to poverty each year, a main cause of poverty in India. 50 million people every year going down the poverty line. Out-of-pocket health expenditure as a percentage is 58%. US is 11, China is 34, world average is 18. Among emerging economies, public government spend in healthcare, India is lowest of 33. Even Cuba does better than us. Costly private equity funds. Everyone says, wow, there are lots of funds available to Indian healthcare, but surely it comes at a cost, yeah? Insane real estate costs. We know how India and real estates are. And shortage of qualified human resources cost push factor. So without funding, without real estate, without adequate resources, how do you deliver healthcare? And all of that is cost escalating and escalating all the time. Welcome, healthcare costs. And on top of all that, gaps. This number is all over the place. I mean, how does it matter whether it's going to be 1 million, 2 million, 3 million, 5 million? But people talk about this is the shortage of doctors. We do 50,000 medical graduates a year, and we need 1 million. Yeah? And specialists are 10 to 15%. Oh, sorry. And finally, this is not just in India, mind you. The world will be short of over 13 million healthcare workers in the next two decades. Today it stands at 8 million, world over. So, shortage of resources, world over, and therefore in India, to halt the brain drain of the minimum that we need to do is to really look after our healthcare personnel in the country, and you know what way we are on that. Let me talk about NASSCOM and NATHEALTH. This is what we have articulated. I lead an initiative. And it talks about a whole lot of lofty things. Healthy India, where citizens are health aware, engaged, have equitable access to affordable health coverage, the focus on prevention, early diagnosis, assured minimum quality of care, offered by a vibrant and sustainable ecosystem of public and private players. I mean, this is the vision. And I'm delighted that this is a vision for two premier institutions in the country, NATHEALTH and NASSCOM. NATHEALTH, which is the industry body for healthcare service providers and people who are involved in the who's who is the members of NATHEALTH, and NASSCOM, the who's who of technology industry in the country. And if all of us put together, if we can't really solve the problem of bridging the health divide, then we need to ask, you know, what is the use of this capability and competency that this country possesses? I like this. The reason I thought I would share with you is the healing professions are in the midst of a major sea change, a once-in-a-century shift. We are moving from medicine practice as individual heroism to medicine as a team sport. So I'm delighted with what Dr. Vivek Desai and others do of bringing all of us together. And I am, you know, so encouraged to see that, you know, we share ideas and we are trying to do what is best for the people in this country. And therefore, I do think that coming together of all of us is that first single step of converting this huge problem to one of a team sport rather than one of individual heroism. Indian healthcare system, all of us, I mean, this is the kind of ecosystem that we have in this country. And without collaboration between each and every one of them, we're not going to be able to solve the problem. The poor will continue to be poor. Poor will not have access to or can afford health care. You know, in my 10 years with Infosys, that first day I met Mr. Murthy, Mr. Murthy told me, Swami, I don't want to run a business which is not compassionate capitalism. I actually laughed. I mean, for the life of me, I couldn't understand why a guy in IT industry would talk to me about compassionate capitalism. Yeah, I could never figure that out. I stayed in that company for 11 years. Yeah. But during my 11 years, ladies and gentlemen, let me tell you, in all the decision making I did for that company, I don't think I, you know, even remotely said I need to be compassionate. But guess what? When I moved into a healthcare industry 4 years back, it hit me. It hit me like a bolt from the blue. I said, if there's going to be one industry globally which really requires compassionate capitalism, that's the healthcare industry. And I've been trying to figure out in the last 4 years, and I see evidences of us moving in that direction. There are. There are islands of excellence. There are people who do that. But unless it becomes, pervasive journey for all of us, getting to that milestone of providing health for all will continue to be a dream. So what do we need? What do we need? We need affordable, accessible, reliable, scalable, and sustainable solutions. We need multi-stakeholder collaboration. You saw the kind of stakeholders in healthcare. Many. And we would need pervasive. There's no way on earth. I don't see that in our lifetimes you're going to be seeing that we'll be resource surplus when it comes to healthcare, people, process, technology, financial. We're going to be resource starved. And therefore, the only way to sort of handle that is technology. We have to get out of this brick and mortar to a click and mortar mindset. Immediately when we think of healthcare, we are seeing that changing. All the stuff that was being spoken to us in the morning did really move us from the brick and mortar mindset to that's a great thing to happen. The world today has 500 petabytes of health data. We'll have over 25,000 petabytes by 2020. All the devices that we carry is generating data every minute, every second. They're all useful information. And guess what? Estimates are that in the next 10 years, data sciences will do more for medicine than all biological sciences combined. So we are in the inflection point. But this, while I've described the challenges, great opportunity to build fantastic solutions through an intelligent combination of brick and mortar and technology to deliver on our need for health for all. I mean, look at the technology galore. I'm sure infrastructure, internet, smart cities, personal communication, broadband, digital cameras, Bluetooth, RFID, we're all using it in some form or the other. Look at e-health applications, electronic. I mean, we just had a full session. I must commend the speaker of actually bringing in, because without this, we are not going to get anywhere. It's the most, in my mind, critical and important element of how we're going to be able to deliver healthcare smartly and intelligently. Personal health records, remote patient monitoring, fitness, healthcare support, e-prescribing. All this is big data analytics. Everything is there, out there. Yeah? I'm sure all of us are dealing with it in some form or the other. Yes, I do believe that time is just right to push the agenda. Look at what the government is doing and what many of us are doing. Digital India project, the government is telling us they're going to spend 1 lakh crore on digital India. And we are now constantly engaging the government and saying how much of it is going to come to healthcare. A good question to ask. I can't for the life of me understand how we can build smart cities without having smart healthcare. Yeah, point to ponder. All this. Understated focus on healthcare education. The government says, we have focused on this. But the good point to take away from all of this is, at least the thinking caps are on. The platform, people think that the platform is important and critical. And therefore, I think the time is just right for us to push the pedal. Technology has the potential. It'll enable us to leapfrog. This is the only thing that'll enable us to leapfrog and meet all those first six slides that I talked about crisis situation that we all face. There are islands of excellence exist, but needs integration. Solutions have to be swift to implement, scalable, sustainable, and cost-effective, and easy to access and use. I normally try and do this. I said, listen, I have been a part of technology for 11, 12 years in this country. Now, last 5 years, I've been in healthcare. So have I made a difference? Is a question that I ask myself. And I land up asking this question to people whom I have an opportunity to speak. And I want to take a quick poll here. Also because I know that some of you may just be dozing off, so I thought good idea to wake you guys up. First question, how many of you are delighted with the admission and the appointment processes that you have personally experienced in hospitals in this country? Raise hand. Delighted with the admission and appointment processes in the hospital that you may have had opportunity to deal with? Raise hands. I hope you're one person here. That's Vivek, your personal hospital, what? Because of healthcare executive. Thank you. Can you imagine? Not one other hand has went up. And in some form or the other, all of us are involved either with technology or with healthcare. Second question, that is A for you, huh? A for you, admission and appointments. How many of you have been delighted with the way that you were, forget about healthcare costs, because that's, you know, very relative term. How many of you are delighted with the billing process in hospitals that you have visited? That when you got the bill or when the patient was admitted or whatever, you know, there were no surprises. How many of you were delighted and said, wow, you know what? This is what I expected and this is what I got. Raise hands. This is up, right? So he only gets appointments. He doesn't, you know, bills he is surprised. Okay, that's B for you, billing. How many of you are delighted with the way that your clinical records are handled by the hospital? You know, my dad is a 91-year-old man, and once in 3-4 months I have to take him to a doctor. And I tell dad, you know what, today I've got an appointment at 9:30 with the doctor. At 6 o'clock when I come down, he's already on his bed and he's got some 25 files around him. And he's struggling with papers. He looks so stressed out. And then, you know, by 7:45 he would have got himself up and ready to go to the doctor. Then we'll go to the doctor and the doctor will say, okay, show me the records. He'll show him, he'll look through his file. But where is that, you know, x-ray that we took, you know, 40 days ago? That'll be, every time I've seen, the document that the doctor wants to see is the one that's missing on the file. And he gets even more stressed. Clinical records, anyone? Delighted? None? I hope you guys are not dozing with your eyes open. Not even one. Okay, that's C. The final one is a killer. How many of you have been delighted with the way your friends or relatives or yourself, if unfortunately you've ever been admitted to a hospital, delighted with the discharge process you experienced at the hospital? Yeah? D. Guys, I can't believe it. I've addressed at least about 30, 40 groups of people in the last about year or so. And I've asked these questions. At least I'll find one or two hands going up. In this, I just found one answer going up for one question. That's A for admission and appointment, B for billing, C for clinical records, D for discharge. Guess what? We haven't got A, B, C, D right in this healthcare so far. And we're talking about technology, we're talking about, you know, social media, cloud, analytics, mobility, artificial intelligence, machine language, you know, all that stuff. Thing to ponder, guys. And is it rocket science? It is not. That's it, social media, mobility. You know, we talk about all of this. And you just said that, you know, you've never, ever been delighted. And guess what? We are not delighted despite the fact that we go to perhaps one of the top 3 or 4 hospitals. That would be our experience. Think of the guys who are at the bottom of the pyramid. You know, this earlier speaker, just before lunch, talked to us. Lots of initiatives happening. This is what he was talking about, the proposed integrated health information platform. There are three. There is a Center for Health Informatics. There is a Mobile Health Authority. There's a e-health authority. There's all kinds of formations that are out there focusing on some of these areas. Good first steps, but we just have to see the end of the tunnel. I'm not seeing it as of today. I have now started saying normal has to be the new normal. What we have actually done is, we've got specialty and referral hospitals in that blue triangle, then the general and district hospital, primary healthcare centers, and then the Anganwadi stuff. Yeah? This is how the normal is expected to be. Lot more people getting basic healthcare right, very little going up the chain to tertiary care. What we have successfully done in this country is we have reversed the pyramid. Very little get effective primary and preventive health care. And therefore, we push a lot and lot of people to the top end, which becomes more expensive when there's no support. So, apart from technology, the one thing that we probably need to do and need to do in a hurry is to actually go back to the new normal, which has to be the old normal. And that can only happen, guys, if we start focusing on the primary and the preventive healthcare in this country. You know, people ask me, Swami, what the hell are you saying? You know, I work for a commercial hospital. My motive in life is to make the maximum returns for the hospital. Give 25% returns to my investors. Yeah? And then still say that, you know what we should be doing? We should keep people away from hospital. My guys are surprised and shocked. What does this guy say? He must be insane. But you know, guess what? I've done different verticals in my life. In the last 5 years as the chairman of a hospital chain, the one thing that I've never been worried about is who my next customer is going to be. Who the next customer is going to be. If I have unutilized capacity, it is not because there are no sick people out there. It is because something is wrong within my own team, or within my own structure. It's all internal. It's never out there. If I get all that right, I'll laugh all the way to the bank. I mean, we are talking about billion bed short, million doctor short, 2 million this short, 3 million that short. Why are we advertising for hospitals? I have not been able to understand. Yeah? So there must be something structurally wrong. There is. And that's what we need to figure out and correct. So the last two slides, I really want to focus on solutions, which is what we are working on. And the whole thing is about how do we bridge the health divide. Start looking after people at the bottom end of the pyramid. And how do we leverage technology to be able to do that? Because there is a serious problem out there, huge problem out there. I want to say this for effect. You know, when I joined Infosys and I had my first conversation with Mr. Murthy, he said, Swami, you know what? I don't want to run a business which is not profitable. I don't want to run a business which is not scalable. I don't want to run a business which is not sustainable. I do not want to run a business which is not predictable. And I do not want to run a business which is not de-risked. Profitable, scalable, sustainable, predictable, de-risked. It's stuck to me like, you know, a gospel truth. And I did a lot of my business decisions based on then when I was outside of healthcare. And I was reasonably successful. When I came to healthcare, I started using the same framework. Guess what I realized? I said, I can be as profitable as I want. No one can stop me. I can predict my results quarter on quarter. I know which month dengue will have, which month pneumonia will be there. What will happen? I can predict it. No problem. I can sustain another 100 hospitals in this country. I'm not only talking about my group. I can be as profitable, as predictable, as scalable, as sustainable. You know what? The only thing that kept me awake was I thought my model was completely at risk. So I used to articulate this with my team, my leaders and others, sometimes with my board, and they'd say, why would you say that? What risk are you seeing? I said, the risk I see is that when 1 billion people are angry at the 200 million people, the people who are our stakeholders, no business is safe. Think about it. Today in this country, all of us who have great access to healthcare or run great institutions, there are 1 billion people out there who are angry at us. Yeah? So I do believe that focus on private-public partnership, because all of us are in islands of excellence. If you have to solve that problem, you just have to come together. Look what a government and NASSCOM can do on technology expertise. Leverage solutions developed by NASSCOM. Now, NASSCOM members have developed. I'm sure many of you are part of that group. All the new startups, new devices, amazing stuff that's happening around there. Youngsters, we talked about millennials. We talked about all of that in the morning. Fantastic stuff happening around us. But how do we integrate all of them to deliver on the ground? and in a hurry. We can't be saying that we'll do this 10 years from now, 20 years from now. By that time, the damage would be done. Convert communities to digital health areas. We have to convert that village, that community, that city to a digital health area. Otherwise, we cannot say that we are digitized. Even in the community that I live, I have no clue of the disease burden in that community. I only know of, you know, sporadic cases of people when they come to me, Swami, you are with Manipal group, so we want this help, that help, then I know. But I do not have a fix on, is my community healthy or not healthy? We don't have a clue. And this is supposed to be like reasonably up-end community. Launch of health, so convert communities to digital health areas. Launch of health information highway across the digital. Health information highway, nothing but EHR and MHR. Nothing. I mean, if we don't know what we don't know, how are you going to solve that problem? And today, honestly, guys, we don't know what we don't know. You know what we don't know about us, but I don't know what I don't know about my dad, about my mom. Honestly, even that I don't know. It's a sad state to be in. Predictive analytics, we talk about big data, you know all that? Petabytes of data. How are you going to use it? There are tools available, and guess what? Today, Indian organizations are actually using all of that to deliver great value to companies in the US. In Europe, and we don't do it for India.